In the answer to your first question, a lot of times, firstly, let's address the issue of holiness. In my opinion, there's no such thing. We are all just children of God, and we have the ability to actually be real or not be real. Now, when we're real, we are at the most purest form we can be. Now, when we're real and we've got a heap of anger, then obviously we need to release the anger and release all of that stuff to become angerless. And when we're real about that, we'll release all of that anger and the sadness that drives the anger, and we'll get to the point where there's no anger in us, and we'll be real in that space too. So in my mind, being real is far more important than being holy. Holiness is a manufactured state of people who believe they have to be religious in order to connect to God in some way. And holiness is a fabrication of the human psyche, really, in the end. It's a fabrication of what's real. And there are many people in the sixth dimension of the spirit world who believe themselves to be holy, and yet they are not real, right? And in fact, one of the greatest complaints from the spirit world that I have when I start talking to them about my own identity is that they believe I'm not holy enough to be Jesus. Right? Now, there's obviously many spirits in the spirit world who know who I am quite clearly, but many spirits will not accept my identity just because I'm not holy enough. I don't do the holier than thou thing, that everybody expects me to do. And I never have, right? And you know how, sometimes we go around to people's place for dinner and they say, oh, do you want to say a prayer for us? For what? I say. And they go, so they say, for the meal. And I say, why? What does God want from me with this meal? He wants me to enjoy it. And there's my prayer. And if I enjoy it and I really express my enjoyment of it, I've expressed my enjoyment to the person who prepared it, and I'm also expressing my enjoyment to God in that process, right? Which is actually a prayer. That's actually holy, if you think about it from God's definition. That's being real as well. But me sitting down and go, all right, let's all close our eyes and hold hands and, let's do this, to God, that's all just a fabrication. That's a fabrication of holiness in order to create something. So you did not have the experience because you were especially holy or unholy. Does that make sense? You had the experience because there was the ability for a couple of spirits to take you out of body, to experience some things in the spiritual world, to help you work through the issues of why you are so afraid of death. Does that make sense?
Yeah. On a shallow level at the moment, I think I'd have to put some deep thought into that. But I like where you're going with it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do. Well, the reason being,
I'm not going anywhere. That all I'm doing is feeling their intention of why they did it with you and telling you what their intention is. I'm not telling you a fabrication.
Thank right. you.
I'm just saying why they did what they did and why they did it to try to assist you. And they had the ability to do it because of the freeness of yourself to allow that particular event to occur. Now, it hasn't cured your fear of death, has it?
I don't think so,
no. And the reason why is because often what happens is we have these out-of-body spiritual experiences which help us go through some things and realize some things, but we don't deal with the underlying emotional reason why we're afraid in the first place still. So while these spirits assisted you to realize there is an afterlife, there is some emotion in you that still needs to be addressed that will, when you release it, you will no longer be afraid of death. Do you follow?
Yeah.
Yeah. And these events will help you. Many of us can experience these events if we're willing. And these events will help you actually overcome the fears enough to actually want to deal with the underlying reason why you have the fear emotionally. So if you can allow yourself to emotionally go into why you have this fear of death, what are you really afraid of with death? It will help you a lot.
Thank you, AJ. Do you think that would have been my guides, or do you think it was angelic beings?
I believe they are your guides, yeah. It's rare for other people just to come along and do something in an unplanned way without you having some kind of law of attraction with them. So in other words, and your guides in particular are always concerned about your spiritual welfare. So that they will do things to help you spiritually grow as much as they possibly can. So if they have the ability to take you out of body to have a certain experience, they'll often do that to help you see the experience. And one of the things you saw was a beautiful landscape, a beautiful area as well. Not just the feeling of love, but you also saw, if you like, what love means in the spirit world to a degree. And they were showing you those things in order to display to you that, you know, there is a reality beyond this earth. There is this reality that's far exceeds what's happening on the earth.
Thank you, AJ. Yeah.
If we come straight down here and then we'll go up to back to Gary.
Yes, I feel that I've had out-of-body experiences through guides, through trauma,
yes,
and through fear of facing my emotions.
Yes.
Could you talk about them or how they relate and if there is any difference between them?
Certainly. Do you want to do any more channeling? Are you? Is there any more spirits who want to talk?
I don't think so. I think I think Jerry would like is happy enough to wait. I think he's gained a huge amount after
from
what's happened.
John discussion.
Yeah.
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 So we'll wait and see. I'll keep talking to him anyway. But
okay. I don't want to answer these
questions. Yeah. No. And it's you. Great to no. Yeah. I'm. Yeah. No. That's good. And I need to go to the toilet too.
No worries. No worries.
Thank you.
Thanks, one. So thanks so much, Monica,
You're so
for
welcome.
Doing that.
Thank you.
And what you raise is a very important issue, actually. The truth is that the majority of people on the planet go out of body when it comes to dealing with an emotion. And the reason why is that we often don't want to. And so what we do to avoid our emotions or even avoid our body is to go out of body for a bit. And that gets us away from our emotion. And so when we go out of body, the key thing to look at there is what's my intention here? And often our intention is to get out of the emotion, to get away from it rather than experience it. What we want to do instead of doing that is draw ourselves back into our body, feel the body's aches and pains and emotions, and just express that emotionally rather than actually jumping out of body all the time to avoid it. The more you can stay in your body on the divine love path, the faster you will progress. On the natural love path, the more you go out of body, the faster you progress. It's almost like the opposite. And many people who have had a New Age background have been taught to go out of body so well that it's an automatic process almost. And when we're avoiding emotion, many of us go out of body quite rapidly as well. When it comes to trauma, it's often a way of avoiding the pain of the body to go out of body. And again, you can stay in your body and actually not have the pain of your body. But it requires removing quite a lot of fear-based emotions before that can happen. So when we go out of body after trauma, it's usually based on fear-based responses that we don't want to face emotionally. And if you can face those fear-based responses emotionally, what will happen is there'll be less of a tendency to go out of body when you're faced with trauma. And what will happen is you will actually face the trauma in your body but actually be able to control the pain of it, because pain is the response of fear, not of staying or going out of your body. So do you understand what I mean by that? Fear creates pain. So it's the fear that's inside of our body that creates the pain of the body. So you will get to a place where you can actually have an injury to your body and actually have no fear about it, right? And have no pain associated with it and heal it immediately as a result, right? And that comes when once you become at one with God, that's what you can do with your own body. Now, the only time that can't occur is if somebody just gets a sword or something and lops off your head instantly. You know, obviously, there's not enough time to consciously evoke those things under those conditions, and so you will pass under those conditions. But if there is a slow-based trauma that's occurring, you can actually, in fact, manage the pain of it completely by by managing the fear of it. And the way you manage the fear of it is by releasing your fears. And all of your fears are old. So all of your fears are based on your childhood, even your parents' fears and all these other things. They will come. Now, when we're in a state where we're at one with God, we will have no fear. And therefore, you're in a state where you have also no pain. But there will be events of trauma that may happen to your body, because there still may be other people who are in fear and pain that create things happening to your body. And so what will happen under those circumstances is you will not have any fear dealing with the problem. And if the problem is not terminal, in the sense that it's not instantly, you know, causing your death, what will happen is you'll be able to actually cure it within and heal it within yourself. So in the first century, there are a number of occasions where I was actually, there were attempts of assassination, quite a number of occasions. And on quite a number of those occasions, I healed, well, every one of those occasions, aside from the last one, I healed myself without having to experience the emotional or physical pain of the event. Yep. When you go out of body, you are also leaving yourself liable for other entities to enter your body. And the problem that many people face on the earth today too is they've gone out of body due to having some very, very strong emotions about wanting to die or wanting to get away from a bad situation in their life or something like that. And sometimes they've gone out of that body and an entity has permanently taken over their body and shares their body with them permanently. Now, we've had ones come along to the groups who have actually in that instant changed their name to the name of the entity who's now taken over their body. So, you know, they might have been called Joe before, but now they're called John, and they tell everybody now they're John, and they change their name by deed poll to John because they actually now believe they're John. But actually it's just an entity that's now overcloaked their body because they themselves chose to go out of body. Now, they are still connected to the body through the silver cord. So the silver cord still connects the physical body with the soul, and that will remain in place until they pass. But because of their desire to stay out of their body permanently, it allows a spirit to come into the body permanently and utilize the body for the spirit's own desires and ends. And that's very different from the third experience you mentioned, which is just having some guides or guardians take you out of body in order to help you get through an emotion. Also, many children who have experienced childhood abuse, violent abuse or sexual abuse, have been purposefully taken out of body by their guides in order to prevent them from feeling the full effects of the abuse that they've actually experienced at the time, because many children would have so much trauma in that event that they wouldn't be able to manage even life after that point. So what they do is many of the guides take a child out of body in a traumatic event in order to prevent them from experiencing the full pain of the event. So there's many times when we go out of body. The key, if you want to progress on the divine love path and progress towards God, is to stay in your body as much as you possibly can. And ways and methods that you can make that occur is by doing exercise. You know, every time you notice you go out of body, go back to the event that triggered the out of body. And in that event, there is some lessons to learn about why I've gone out of body. What actually motivated me to go out of body there? What was I avoiding? You know, you allow yourself to look at the emotion. Come back into your body. Let yourself feel your body's pains. Let yourself feel your body's emotions. Let yourself feel what you feel in that state rather than trying to exit that state all the time. In the spirit world, one of the biggest traumas that occur in the spirit world for a person who's gone out of body most of their life on earth is there's no body to go out of in the spirit world. So they feel the full event. They feel the full amount of the emotions in the spirit body for the first time in their life. And often it's very traumatic because they've gone out of body a lot of their life. And because of the trauma of that, they often stay in quite dark places for a long time, feeling all of this excessive pain that if they allowed themselves to feel in the physical, they wouldn't have to experience as in the spiritual. Yeah.
Would that be a contributing factor to the difficulty I have getting into my emotions?
Definitely, yeah. Always the case. If I can sort of... if I can draw it here... Have we got some decent ones? These ones are... That one's better. It's right, babe, I've got one. So here's your soul. Remember, your soul is the container. So this is your soul, the container of the emotions. The emotions themselves are in your soul. And so no matter whether you're in the spirit world or in the physical world, the emotions are in your soul. But what actually happens in your bodies are the emotions freeze up certain organic areas of both bodies. So in other words, let's say you have an emotion in your soul of feeling unworthiness, like there's a deep feeling of unworthiness towards the feminine, let's say. What will happen is you'll have a lot of pain in this side, your left side of your body, in this second chakra region. So your physical body will have a big sort of energy block there, if you like. Your spirit body will have the energy block in the same location as well, by the way, and it will cause fissures and fragments in your spirit body. It's your actual soul emotion, which is unworthiness towards the female, that actually causes those two things. But now those two things have been caused, they are actually physically present in that location of your body. So you can actually, if you stay in your body, you can press on that location, feel the pain of what that's generating inside of your physical body, and start to allow the emotion to flow. Does that make sense? And this is why a lot of body work actually works in dealing with emotion. When a person stays in their body and presses a certain location in their body, if you allow yourself to stay with your body, you'll most often connect to the emotion that created that physical location's problem. And that physical location will start initially, usually through pain. You'll have pain in that location. And then if you allow the emotions to start flowing, you'll start actually feeling the pain in that location shift. And it will shift through your different systems, either muscular or neuroskeletal. It will shift through the different systems of your body, depending on what the emotion is. So while the emotion's in the soul, one way to access it is by staying in the body, pressing the location, if you like, where there's the pain, and actually allowing the feeling, whatever the feeling is, to overwhelm you in that moment. And that is a very powerful way of actually releasing emotion. The other thing is that every one of these soul-based emotions, remember, are locked up at the age they were created. So let's say I had an event when I was 3 years of age, and at 3 years of age, my mother showed me through one of her actions that I am such a bad boy, right? And so it's my mother interacting with me. So this is an injury now I'm going to have with the feminine. And she's telling me I'm a bad boy, so I feel really bad about myself. There's a lot of shame about myself and what I might have done. You know, I might have taken 5 cents out of a purse or something, but I'm a bad boy because I've stolen or I lied or something like that. And so what she would do is project that emotionally at me, and now this emotion has entered me. But it was three when it happened. I was three. And then when I started crying, because I would probably cry under those circumstances normally, and then she said, "You cry and I'm going to give you something to cry about," she now locked up that emotion at three. So now I've got this three-year-old emotional experience that is now locked up in me because of my fear of pain. So I've now got a causal emotion, which is the underlying feeling of shame or unworthiness about being a boy who's bad. And then on top of that, I've got a blocking emotion of fear, of pain, of punishment sitting on top of that. And that's in my soul, locked up at a three-year-old feeling. Now, if I press this place that it was all locked up in my physical body, there's a high likelihood now, if I allow myself to connect to the emotion, that I'll actually be feeling like I'm three, crying. Does that make sense? Like I'm 3 years old, crying out, "Oh, mummy, I didn't mean it." And, you know, start crying out all these things. And I think, where in the hell did that come from? And where it came from was my soul, right, who has had this locked up emotion since, you know, I was 3 years of age, and I might be 40 or 50 now, and that's how long it stayed in me all that time. No, kinesiology, the question is that like kinesiology? No, kinesiology is more about testing the soul's, if you do it, use it right, it's about testing the emotions that are in the soul. Why do I have this emotion? Why do I have that emotion? the issue with kinesiology is it's not going to help you experience the emotion. It'll just tell you what the emotion is. Right? You still got to experience it. You still got to allow yourself to experience it. So the issue with every tool that we have is, remember, we have like a causal emotion, which is like I described just earlier, the emotion where, of the event when I was three, when mum chastised me because I did something shameful and I feel all the shame and I'm a boy and mum's a girl, obviously I feel shame in respect to the woman. And then on top of that, remember I said there was a block where she said, you cry about that and I'm giving you something to cry about. So I have now a fear of pain as my blocking emotion. The problem is kinesiology can show me that I have a block of a fear of pain, and kinesiology can show me that I have a causal emotion which was related to shame when I was 3 years of age through an event, but it can't access it for me. The only way I can access it is by feeling it, right? And this is where doing things with your body, with body work, is sometimes quite powerful, because you can actually press in the location where that emotion is related to, and it feels like the emotion is actually stored in that location. And you can press in that location and actually start to trigger the emotion as long as you allow the emotion to flow. Right? So that's a very powerful tool. But if you're not in your body and you're getting out of your body all the time, you press in that location, you feel a bit of pain, and bang, you're out of your body. And now you don't feel any pain. Oh, that was good, that was done. Nothing's done. Because when you get back in your body, the pain's back there again. So you know that nothing's really changed. Does that make sense? So in regard to your question, staying in your body is a very powerful way of actually accessing emotion. So the longer you can stay in your body and in any situation, the better it's going to be. So imagine a traumatic situation comes up where you're having an argument, maybe with your mother, right? And these arguments have began when you were, 15 or 14 years of age, and now they're still happening now that you're 40, let's say. And there's a tendency for you to go out into out of body land in order to avoid the trauma of it. So you go into this really relaxed, zened out sort of a state, and mum's talking to you and you're hearing her, but nothing really hurts. And nothing asserting you. Well, what's actually happening in that situation is you could be using the situation totally the opposite. You could actually be staying in your body and allow what's coming at you to actually hurt you, as it has done for the last 30 years, and actually allow yourself to feel the emotion of it. But when we go out of body, there's this tendency to forget about the emotion of it, to disconnect from the emotion. So a lot of people who have had spiritual backgrounds or who have had a lot of trauma in their childhood have gone out of body as a management tool. And we need to learn to actually get back into the body in order to experience things. Things like yoga, also quite powerful if you use it to get back into your body. Some people use yoga to get out of their body, but you want to use it to get back into your body, to feel your body. Massage is often a good way to... And instead of a lot of people, when they go to a massage, they feel so good, they go back out of body again. You pull yourself back into your body and stay in your body. Feel the ache and feel the pain and feel, where it's being pressed. Allow yourself to stay in the body's feelings. A lot of women go out of body with sexual things because they've had sexual trauma in their childhood, and that they went out of body then. And so when they start making love to their husband, even though it's no longer a trauma to do that, they go out of body as a result, and can't orgasm or can't climax because of going out of their body and not being fully connected to their body. And unfortunately, that also allows other spirits to come back in those situations too. And there's a lot of spirits in the spirit world who certainly want to still have sex because they're not having sex there, many of them. And so they'll connect to the body under those circumstances. So you're actually leaving yourself quite open when you go out of body under certain circumstances for there to be external influences occurring. We had a couple of young fellows coming to our groups up at Butterham who would go out of body no matter what conversation you had with them, pretty much, instantly out of body. And instantly these spirits would come in, straight away you're not talking to the person. No matter what you say from now on, you can't help the person get to their emotion because they're away already. So going out of body, powerful way to manage emotion, but not a powerful way to release emotion. Mary, you want to say?
I just wanted to add to that just doing the workshops that we've been doing up north, there's a vast majority of people who go out of their body whenever they're emotionally confronted. Mm. And also during processing, quite a few people reach a point in their processing, and it's just something to note for people, when the emotion gets very intense and it's almost like there's a decision that this is too much, and what we're finding is that spirits come in to express their own emotions in that place. Mm-hmm. And just something to just for everyone to think about, to recognize when that might be happening, is when your emotion is intensifying, especially if your rage is intensifying, it feels very intense, you feel right in it, but you're not breaking through to grief, because when you're really in your rage, you're going to break through to grief. If it's your rage, you're going to break through to grief quite quickly. Mm. It was like within a minute. Yeah. So if you're finding it's intensifying, or you're finding that you're in grief, it's getting really scary, and then suddenly you're shaking, it seems almost out of control. And something really powerful actually that Mon and I did with someone last weekend was just having them remember to breathe. That's a really important thing when you're coming up to an emotion or you're in an emotion, mm. to always remember to breathe, because that's something that very immediately connects you with your body again. Mm. Yeah, I notice it a lot as well with people, like you're saying, coming up to an emotion and then suddenly they're away, like they're not really there. Mm. And very often some other spirit friend of theirs will pop in and just be really firm and tough around, I'm not going there.
And the spirit friend often thinks they're doing them a favour. Like, you know, the spirit friend feels, oh, I'm helping the person because the person doesn't want to feel this. You're trying to make this person feel this when he doesn't want to feel it.
Yeah. And the key there is just to recognize your own terror, mm. and work on that as a block, mm. that I'm actually terrified of what's being triggered, mm. and not to push to get into that emotion, just sit with actually I'm terrified of emotion.
Yeah. Remember, with our emotions, you've often got the causal emotions. You then usually have a set of blocking type emotions. The blocking type emotions generally were created when you were also of the same age. It's the blocking emotions that keep the causal emotions locked up, if you like, and they often occur very similar age groups. So you're talking like, you know, the event I described earlier, three-year-old causal emotion, followed immediately thereafter by a three-year-old blocking emotion of pain. And then what happens on top of that is we start having other types of emotions piled on top of these belief systems that we have, many of which are self-deceiving and so forth. Now, in this area, right down to there, all emotional processing that we're doing is not really helping us very much, because what it's doing is not allowing us to get to the block or get to the cause. Now, when we're in that state, we're in, like, oh, let's call some of that state self-deception, where we believe we have something when we don't really have it and things like that, or we believe it's, oh, I was just rejected last week by a male, and then you go into the whole situation and actually she rejected the male herself, you know, where she's telling herself one thing about what she felt the emotion was really about, but actually it's totally different. All of those things are self-deception. And in that area there, that's where spirits will connect to you, in that areas. So while you stay in these areas, like self-deception, there's also obviously anger.
Self-attack.
So self-punishment, right, is same. When you stay in those areas, you're going to be drawing spirits to you to help you stay in those areas. There are literally like thousands of spirits, there's billions of spirits in the spirit world in the first sphere, who are willing to attack you because you are willing to attack you, for example. Like they want someone to attack. It makes them feel great. It makes them feel powerful. It makes them feel like, you know, there's another person I can attack. They'll let me bang, and away they go from a spirit perspective. And while we're in any of these emotions, we are not really dealing with causal emotion, and we are just heavily influenced by spirits. And if we go out of body in any of those emotions, spirits just lock in on us. And
I've experienced that in my own processing with self-punishment. It gets pretty out of hand, yeah.
So, you know, in self-punishment, you go into self-punishment and you start hitting yourself all of a sudden, right? What's happening right then is you're actually allowing now a person in the spirit world to punish you, just like you would when you were a child and you were being punished by another person, you're now actually allowing that punishment to happen as an adult. And it doesn't help you get to the emotion. In fact, you feel that emotion is easier to feel than that emotion, or even that one, the blocking one. So one of the things that Mary's trying to teach people in the courses that she's doing, the workshops she's doing, is when they're in that compared to when they're actually in that, right, and how to differentiate between those things. Now, you can stay in these places for years and years and years and years, being emotional the entire time and not getting anywhere, right? And you can also go and use the out-of-body tools and getting out of body, getting away from the emotion and feeling, oh, I feel peaceful now, and not get anywhere either. What we want to do is the real soul condition work, which is all about these emotions, these childhood emotions. Or remember, there's a whole set of emotions that I haven't drawn there about that are due with the law of compensation, where we've actually taken unloving actions as a decision we've made ourselves. There's a whole set of emotions associated with those that are all causally based emotions that will change your soul condition. Focus on those emotions. And these emotions are the ones where you've got to be very careful. You still got to feel them, but you've got to be very careful about what you're doing with them, because you can easily delude yourself that you're actually processing something when you're not.
Yeah, and I feel if you're in a blocked place but you're very real about that, that's far better place to be on this path. Then I see a lot of people getting really down on themselves and you have to be emotional, and they go up into those top layers and they end up getting in these cycles of being quite emotional, mm-hmm. but not actually shifting anything.
Yeah.
So it's okay to be blocked and to be really real and sit for 6 months going, I'm terrified of feeling whatever the feeling is,
yep.
and just pray about that, work on that. And if you don't shed a tear, I think
that's a far more healthier, powerful place, yep. than crying every day about self-delusion or self-deception. Do you know what I mean? Far better place. And oftentimes what we're doing emotionally is we're trying to get somewhere, when in reality what we need to be doing is praying about the blockage we have to getting somewhere. You know, it's like the three-year-old child. Look, like as an adult, we're trying to access this three-year-old causal emotion. I know Mum treated me bad. I know that's why I feel bad as a guy. You know, as a guy, I feel ashamed of myself. I feel like I'm a liar, you know, because that's what my mum called me all the time. So I feel like I'm a liar, but I don't know how to release it. Well, instead of focusing on that, what we need to just forget that for a moment, say, what am I afraid of releasing that for? What's my blockage to releasing that? And one of my blockages might just be a simple thing like, if I actually get to that emotion, I'll actually want to talk to my mother about how badly she's treated me. And if I do that, she won't love me. So I don't want to do that. You know, it might be just that simple. That might be the blocking emotion right now as an adult that prevents me from going to that place. But if we go into self-deception and cry about, you know, how my mum treated me and my mum treated me, but every single day nothing changes, I still feel much the same, my soul doesn't feel much, I don't feel the peace that comes or any of those things, then I know that I'm in a place up in this location and it's not helping me at all. I might as well stop. I'm not on the divine love path for a start, and I might as well stop anyway because it's not helping me go anywhere emotionally. It's these things that will help me go to places emotionally. Gary's had his hand up for some time. So.
Been psyching up for this one. I think I've been in the top three, those ones there, because I've just been separated for 8 months and I've been doing a lot of grief and had a lot of grief over Pauline's grief.
Over your wife's grief?
Grief, yeah.
Or your ex-wife's grief?
Ex-wife, yeah. And, it's sort of like sinking into depression and then finding it hard to get to emotion. And I've been, like, praying, you know, about, like, my blocks and trying to be truthful about what's really going on. But I think I'm missing something.
Yep, totally.
If you're
working on an emotion for 8 months and you're not getting anywhere, then you're missing something.
Yeah, I'm missing something, yeah. So that's my question is, what am I missing? And if you can,
Well, it's interesting when we ask questions, because in our questions are often the answer of what is going on. Can you say again what you were doing about your ex-wife's emotions?
I was... I was grieving over her emotion.
So you have a male, so you're the male. This is your ex-partner, who is also an adult, so both adults, and you were grieving over her emotions, right? Is that it?
Yeah, and it sort of got muddied in, I'd grieve over that and then grieve over the loss and it'd get... Yeah.
It's going to be very muddy doing this. Because you're actually identifying the underlying causal emotional reason why you're not getting at emotions quite readily, but you're not seeing it for the trees sort of thing. You're not seeing the forest for the trees. The actual emotion that you need to experience is, why are you hooking in to the woman's emotion? You have a desire to hook in to the woman's emotion rather than experiencing your own. Does that make sense? You want to experience the woman's emotion instead of experiencing your own. You would rather experience hers than your own. So you notice her emotion, let's say her emotion is what, she was ashamed of something when she was a child. You'll cry about that, but you won't cry about your own shame as a child. So can you see, you are hooking in to the woman's emotion and using that as a tool to deny your own. And this is a pattern that began in you very young age, obviously with your mother, right? What your mother did with you, her interaction with you is desired you to hook into her stuff, hook into her stuff, hook into her stuff, hook into her stuff. And as you're hooking into her stuff, you're not feeling your own. You become heavily invested in the woman's emotion in order now to avoid your own emotion. And so what's playing out is actually this deep desire inside of you to do whatever you can do for the woman. Does that make sense? And that is actually preventing you from feeling your own emotion. And there's some very basic and easy to understand reasons why, if you think about it. If you're investing in her emotion, if she thinks you're a, you know, if she thinks you're a bastard, that's her emotion. One of her emotions, shall I say.
One of them, yeah.
Right? She thinks you're a bastard. You go and take on, yeah, you're a bastard. And you cry about how much of a bastard you were. But you may not have been a bastard. You're just talking into her belief that you're a bastard. And why would you do that? You see, if you were really a bastard and you cried about being a bastard, you'd be over it in a week. Right? And it would be free, you'd be free of it. If it was a really a repentant type of emotion, you'd be free of it. If you're still crying about being a bastard 8 months later, then obviously you're just hooking into her emotion that she thinks you're a bastard. Does that make sense? So there's something inside of you where you would prefer to do that, to think you're a bastard and to cry about that on a regular basis, rather than what?
Then like feel like rejection from the woman, or
exactly to feel that the woman's wrong and you have to go to tell the woman, actually you're wrong. I wasn't that much of a bastard at all, now that I think about it. Right? And in fact, now that I think about it, you were angry with me for our whole 20 years of marriage, right?
Yeah, 30.
Oh, 30 years of marriage, right? You were angry with me for our whole 30 years of marriage, right? And I'm the bastard, like, who's the bitch? Do you know what I mean? Like, you'd be asking yourself these questions, you know what I mean?
And so I've never allowed myself to get angry at, like...
Well, you won't allow yourself to get angry at the woman. Instead, you would prefer to be angry with yourself. You'd prefer to cry about yourself, be angry with yourself and all those other things, and none of them are causal emotions. And so you can cry about it for the next 25 years and nothing's going to change. Does that make sense? And you're doing that because you want something from the woman. What do you want from her?
Approval.
Approval, acceptance.
It's like to the love, mother, going back to the mother.
Care, nurturing. These are all the things, eh?
Plus a few more.
Yeah. And what's happening is you're so addicted to getting these things from the woman that you are prepared to accept an untruth about yourself in order to get them. So woman tells you a bastard, so you're a bastard. Woman tells you, you know, you're no good lying, thieving scoundrel, you're a no good lying, thieving scoundrel now.
Because I think I might be afraid, like, I haven't got any grief left. Like, them, you know, and I judge myself for that.
Well, the truth is actually that you're so heavily invested in the woman's emotions and beliefs that you're not even willing to see the truth. And if remember, if you're not willing to see the truth on the divine love path, you can never relieve a causal emotion. So why do you want to do this? Because it's less painful than actually feeling the rejection. It's less painful in feeling that my mum never approved of me, she never accepted me, she never loved me, she never cared for me, and she never nurtured me. And, ironically, your ex-wife never did those things either. Right? And you don't even want to face that. Can you see that? You don't even want to face the grief, the fact that she didn't do those things either. Do you see what I'm saying? And so what you would prefer to do instead is tell yourself that you were to blame. And have big cries about how bad you were and how, you know, get angry with yourself. Why couldn't I have been different, you know? Get angry with her sometimes. You know, why can't she tell me what I'm doing wrong? Right? All that stuff. And all that stuff is just to avoid a group of emotions. So what's actually happening is for a period of 8 months now, you've been trying to avoid the group of emotions of the deep pain surrounding your mum. But the way you could hook into it quite rapidly or get to it quite rapidly is through the deep pain you feel of having a 30-year relationship with a woman who didn't love you.
Yeah. That could, like, trigger me into my own stuff.
Yes, yeah. but as soon as you go into a state of blaming yourself for her not loving you, right, you are now telling yourself an untruth. Are you to blame for a person who doesn't love you? Ever, even if you're the worst possible scoundrel in the universe, right? Are you to blame if another person doesn't love you? Right? Love is a gift. So if a person doesn't love you, they're just unwilling to give the gift. Doesn't matter. You can do like people who are terrible get the gift of love sometimes. Why didn't you? So whenever you tell yourself, I'm the bastard, I'm the scoundrel, I'm the person, I'm this, I'm that, and you cry about all of that, you're actually not releasing a causal emotion. You're actually avoiding the causal emotion. The causal emotion is, my mother never approved of me. How does it feel?
I feel lost.
How does it feel to have a mother who never cared for you or loved you? Inside of you, how does it feel?
Feel quite panicked and alone and empty.
Yeah, you feel devastated, yeah. Actually. Yeah. And that's the emotion you don't want to feel. Mm. So you'd rather blame yourself. You'd rather say to yourself, oh, my mum didn't love me because I was a bad boy. My mother, and really that's what you're doing with your ex. Can you see that? Mm. No. Mm. She didn't love me because it was my fault she didn't love me.
Mm. And like, because like I got a lot of fear to go there, it's like, you know, like with prayer, like what would be like, you know, a prayer I could like to help me?
Well, at the moment, Gary, you're in this addiction with women. So what you're doing is you're seeking out women who tell you you're a nice man because they are giving you approval, acceptance and love. Does that make sense? And this addiction is causing you to get out of your real emotion. If you look at it, I'm doing a talk next week about how to process addictions. And this is what you're really in, is this process of how do I process my addiction to have a woman wanting to love, I want a woman to love me all the time. And if my ex-wife doesn't, I want someone else to, you know, just because in the end I just have so much pain about mum not loving me, and that's the pain I want to avoid. So what we do, if we're honest with God, we would say, actually God, I want to avoid the pain that my mother didn't love me, and ask yourself, and ask God, well, can you show you why you want to avoid that pain? And a lot of times we already know the answer to that, and you already know the answer. It's devastating. I don't want to go and be devastated for the next 3 months. You know, do I want to be crying every day for the next 3 months about how much my mum doesn't love me? A lot of times we don't. We want to have a life. We want to get on. We want to be happy. We want to, you know, go out to the movies and, you know, whatever. Instead of doing that, don't we? That's what we want. And so we're not honest with ourselves. So let's be honest with yourself. The truth is that this emotion, and often that's how I talk to God, the truth is that this emotion feels so devastating to me, I don't want to feel it. Now, I have a choice. I can choose to try to get to feel it at some point. I can firstly look at my blockages to feeling it. What am I afraid of feeling it? Why am I so afraid of feeling it? And I can even pray about getting a desire to even feel why I'm blocked towards feeling it. You see, a lot of times we don't even have a desire to know that we're blocked towards feeling the emotion. So if you find inside of yourself you don't even have a desire to know, then pray about the desire. If you find you do have a desire to know and you're really passionate and would like to know, then pray about the blockages that you have, the fears that you have about getting to know. And look really sincerely at every single law of attraction event with women where you are trying to get their approval, every one of them. You know, and so you got someone lying on the table. You're doing kinesiology or whatever, and you've got someone lying on the table, and she says to herself, "I'm a terrible woman." And you go,
"Oh, no, you're not."
Straight away, straight into the hook. Can you see? Like, straight in. And then what you do is you go, "Oh, I've done it again. Like, what did I want from her now?" Like, just look straight. Look, I did it again. Pray to God straight away in that moment. I've done it again. The same pattern. I'm trying to tell her she's good when she's just about to process an emotion, actually. And you see, a lot of times what we do, we want these emotions of love, acceptance, care and everything from our mother. So what we do is we try to make mum feel good so that she feels good enough to love us. Right? So a lady gets on your table, you want to make her feel good enough to love you. That's fairly big ulterior motive for having her on the table, but that's the way it goes. And that's part of the law of attraction. You look at the majority of your clients are?
Yeah, they're women.
Yeah, exactly. Why are the majority of clients women? Because?
I've attracted them.
You've attracted them. Why have you attracted them? Because?
Yeah, they can make me feel good.
Particularly if they deal with their emotions, they'll make you feel even better. Right? Mum never dealt with hers and she made you feel terrible, but if these women deal with their emotions. So what do you want to do? Help the woman deal with her emotion. Why? So that she'll make you feel better. Right? And it's not really a pure desire in the end. It's actually driven by this desire to avoid a whole group of causal emotions. So what I do personally in those circumstances is I look at every single moment, what's going on in this interaction. What did I just say? Why did I just say that? She needs to feel her stuff, you know? Like, I'm trying to tell her she's a good woman. She's feeling she's a bad woman. Yes, you're a bad woman. Feel that, you know? Go ahead and feel that. After you feel that, you'll feel like you're a better woman after that. But why am I trying to tell her now she's a good woman? Straight away, I'm hooking into this same thing. Look at the fact that you even have a group of woman clients. You'll know when you're dealing with the causal emotion when you start getting some men clients. Does that make sense? Where there's some balance there's some sexual balance in your clientele, because what's happening now is you're not having a strong longing. And the world is full of women who want to reassure the man that she loves them. Does that make sense? Why does she do that? Because her daddy needed reassurance that he was loved. You know, same. It's the flip side of your emotion. And so what we do is we attract that group of women. You look at every woman in your practice. How many of them are very hooked into making the man feel like he's loved? Quite a high percentage.
Yeah, a lot of them.
Yeah. Yeah. So can you see the dynamics are going on?
Double addiction.
Yeah. And the key is to try and break those addictions, and you can only break them if you have a desire to, obviously. Mm-hmm. And having desire to is about praying about the addiction, praying about the expectation, praying about the emotion you're avoiding in this. And the emotion you're avoiding is usually the opposite of the addiction. So my addiction is, I want the woman to make me feel good. What am I avoiding? I actually feel bad when I'm with women. Feel it. I actually feel like I'm a terrible man when I'm with women. So feel that. Rather than avoiding that by having a woman tell you you're a nice fellow. And you deny a lot of truth as well, Gary, in your interaction with women. So, you know, you have a feeling from a woman that she's not very nice, she's a bit angry, but what do you tell her instead?
It's something else.
Exactly. Anything else but that, that the truth. Because if you tell her that truth, what will happen?
Oh, there's a fear of upsetting him and not getting the approval.
She will get angry with you, therefore you won't get your addiction met. And so what you do is tell her an untruth instead. So in every interaction with women now, start telling them the truth of what you feel in this interaction. You follow me? Like, so the truth might be, actually, you're very angry with men, hey? And she gets even angrier with you, right? And you test her. Yes, you're very angry with men. And she gets even angrier again with you. Yes, well, now we can see you are. We don't need to test that one again. But you can see that what you're trying to do is avoid all those things. And the truth is that the majority of problems that are on the planet between the genders are the results of anger and rage between, you know, the genders, obviously. And we need to heal them. The only way we heal them is by disconnecting from the addiction, right, and feeling our own emotion about why we had that addiction. And the truth is that I've said some really confronting things to Mary in our time together about addictions. And I won't repeat some of them because some of them get quite, some of them are a bit personal.
You can hammer me if you like it.
An addiction is a bartering system. And we need to understand that what we're doing is we're bartering something for something else. And what you're doing in this process is you are bartering yourself. You are giving of yourself. You are punishing yourself for the sake of getting an emotion from a woman. And so what you need to come face to face with, is that you are just as in error in this interaction as she is. Like, she doesn't love you, and what you're doing is you're earning her love. And when you earn her love, she gives you love. And you think, oh, beautiful, I feel love now. And she feels great now because she's made a man feel good. And both of us in that situation have actually just tickled each other up. Do you know what I mean? In a sexual connotation, it's like we've both just played with each other, right, to make each other feel good, and we've just ignored the emotion. That's what we've done. And we need to see that's what we're doing. We need to see and understand that we're actually offering compromise in order to get compromise constantly. And, of course, we're never going to get closer to God doing that. Yeah.
Thanks, AJ.
No worries. Does that help too with why you're stuck?
Yeah, that's pretty direct, yeah.
Yeah, well, you know I'm direct, so if we come down here. Yeah,
thanks.
Hi, AJ.
How you doing?
Related to what you've just been talking about,
yep.
I've got some questions around relationship.
Yep.
I've been spending a lot of time processing for myself around being fully in one or choosing to be fully out.
Yep.
And what I find is happening for me is I choose to stay there and I go, I'm going to work on my stuff and it will become clear.
Yep.
And I'll process an emotion and my heart will open and I'll feel great and I'll get closer.
Mm-hmm.
Then I'll go back into another layer of stuff and I'll start questioning whether or not I want to be there and I'll get really anxious and whatever.
Mm-hmm.
The question has come to me as to whether the real point of what I need to be looking at is whether or not to say no to something I don't want. And am I using, I'll just keep processing as an excuse not to deal with that. And I'm just trying to make myself fit into something that I don't really want. Or am I really wanting to stay there and process?
It's an interesting question you've raised. I'm just a bit distracted because I need my drink. of water, wherever I've put that. No, it's not that.
It's just the other side of the chair.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's it. Thank you. I just need to have a drink and then I'll answer you. All right. Firstly, you can't be given any set rules as to when to really step out of a relationship and when to step into one. The reason why is that obviously it's going to depend day to day on what happens in the relationship is what you will choose to do. There's many times in a relationship where you may step out of it for a day, go back and things have changed, and step back into it again. And you may do that for many months or even years before you actually have a solid relationship with a person that's actually loving on both sides. So it's very important to firstly not make a set rule of how to deal with anything with regard to how a relationship should be, you know, processed and left or not left. But there are some general guidelines that you, of course, need to consider. So here's you. Here's your partner. What are the occasions under which you feel you should leave?
When I feel controlled, but I've been working with a lot of my father issues around that, and so that's losing its impact.
Occasion is when you feel controlled. Is there any others that come to mind? Like
a fear of losing my sense of self.
Okay.
And so that I'll stop realizing.
It's not loose.
What I want. And I'll just think that I want what he wants.
Yep.
But a big one is he's not on the divine love path and he's not interested in looking at his emotions. Mm-hmm. Those are the main ones, I think.
Awesome. Okay. You're probably not going to like my answers.
Probably not.
there's so much I could say to you. Maybe Mary should come and say it all. These are all feelings Mary has had aside from the last one with myself. And in the end found that actually all of these didn't relate to anything I was doing, but actually related to everything about her father and her life in the first century and a few other things with her as to what was going on.
On the last point, you could substitute not doing whatever I
want. Yeah, Mary just said for the sound. She could substitute not on the divine love path and not doing anything I want. Because Mary did feel that I wasn't doing anything she wanted. A lot of this is furphy land for you. In other words, self-deception. Okay? And self-deception emotions are very, very powerful, so powerful that you'll even consider breaking a relationship for them when in reality the emotion that's inside of you is the issue rather than in your partner. All right? Let's look at, firstly, not on the DLP, not on the divine love path. Is it right for me, if I love somebody, is it right for me to expect them to do anything?
No.
Am I being loving if I expect them to do something?
No.
So if I expect him to process his emotions, am I being loving?
No.
So who's the one being loving? Is he expecting you to process his emotions?
I think so.
Are you sure about that?
No.
Okay. You feel controlled, which is part of that. So does he say, you deal with your emotion about this? Do you deal with the emotion? Otherwise, I'm leaving you.
No.
Okay. So who's the person in expectation?
Me.
Okay. Who's the person who's most harmonious with love?
He is.
Ah. All right. Now, that's tricky to face, right? Now there's many, well, and instead of judging it, what we need to do is look at the underlying reason why it's going on rather than judging it. So not on the divine way path is an expectation you have, an expectation that's actually unloving of him. And in fact, you think about it. When you're growing up at any point in your life, every time someone else has had an expectation of you, what have you done with it? How do you react to expectations yourself? So if I said today, like, I expect you to cook a cake for us tonight.
I feel angry.
Okay. You don't want to follow the expectation,
no,
do you?
No.
You don't?
No.
That's what he's doing with you right now. Okay. One of the main reasons why he is not dealing with his emotions on the divine love path is because of your expectation.
Okay. Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. Totally.
Your expectation is actually unloving, and he, in a loving manner, should resist it. Because if he didn't resist it, he would be helping you being unloving. Does that make sense?
Yes, yes.
So any expectation that you have, when you say, oh, he's not on the divine love path, so I don't know if I should be with him, you're really in an unloving place in that moment. And understand that is a desire for him to do what you want.
Yeah.
And should he do what you want? What should he do?
No, he needs to do what he wants.
Yes. God wants him to do what he wants.
Yes.
And if what he wants is desires you with all of his heart, he will be with you.
Yeah.
Right? If that's what he wants.
Yes.
And if he doesn't desire you with all of his heart, then you'll sooner or later feel that and you'll probably leave to find a person who does desire you with all of their heart. Does that make sense? But it won't be because he's either on the divine love path or not on it and not doing what you want.
No.
You were going to say?
Yeah. On that point, I've questioned myself because of asking myself, what is it that I actually want? Rather than wanting him to be different, although I recognise that I have expectations and I have recognised that.
Can I just address, you very quickly dismissed your own unloving behaviour in that statement.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And this is something we've got to be very careful on the divine love path. You see, often what we do is we project at other people about their unloving behaviour, and in the process, we at that time are being unloving.
Yeah.
And we've got to, like, see what's really happening. So when you say, I understand that, but you're actually dismissing your own unloving behaviour, which is quite unloving, in that there's this huge expectation that he does what you want. And because he's not doing what you want and not fitting into your box that you want him to fit in, you don't feel you can love him. So what does that tell you about your love for him? Does it tell you that it's unconditional or conditional?
Oh, very conditional, which makes me question whether I should be there.
Well, wouldn't an alternative be learn how to unconditionally love him?
Yeah.
That's an alternative. That'd be actually more in harmony with God, that alternative.
Yeah.
But yes, you can choose to leave him, but just because you know you're not being unconditionally loving, you can choose to do that too. But that usually doesn't help you be more unconditionally loving.
True.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
It doesn't help you do that.
Yeah.
What will help you do that is by actually remaining there and learning how to unconditionally love this man who basically is being more loving by not demanding the same things of you that you're demanding of him. Right? Now, these two things are very big emotional injuries for females on the planet, right? Due to the history of things, the history of the interaction between males and females, in history, throughout history, from 2,000 or 3,000 years ago to now, females have been dominated by the male's physical characteristics. In other words, the male's bigger size and usually stronger desire towards anger, and the male's belief that the male is superior to the female causes the female to have in them the feeling, right through history, and it is a true feeling, that they are being controlled and don't have a sense of self. Does that make sense? So all through history, most women on this planet have had this total control over their lives. In the first century, we were surrounded by families who were basically, the woman was the slave, right? And she was not only just the physical slave, she was the sexual slave. She was all of these different aspects of slavery was all a part of her married life. Like she was married to a man, but she was basically his slave. Right? And he viewed her no better than the donkey he bought her with. Right? That's how it was. And that's how it has been. And still in nations on the earth today, it is still the same way. There are nations on the earth today where there is still no law about murdering your wife. Right? So that's how much control there's been historically over the woman. Now, the question then becomes, is this man controlling you? You see, the problem we have when we have multi-generational abuse for over many centuries is that we have all these beliefs in us about what's actually happening, that all men are bastards, that all men are controlling, that all men are this and all men are that. We have all these beliefs. And we colour the relationship with the belief. Does that make sense? So what we do is we walk into this relationship, and as soon as he tells me what he wants to do, I feel he's controlling. Or like I find myself cooking every night and he's controlling. Now, did he ask me to cook every night? What does he do when I don't cook for him one night? Does he complain or does he cook for you? What does he do? That's the measure of whether he's controlling, not my imagination of, and when I say my imagination, it's not my imagination, it's my soul's emotions from my history of events that have occurred. And this is where we must be very careful in a relationship. Because a lot of the times we blame our partner for doing something that actually we ourselves are doing to them. And we don't know. So do you want to speak more about this? I know you've got a lot to say about it. Mary's got a lot of feelings about this. But what happens is often we feel we are controlled when we are actually being controlling. And we feel that we're losing our sense of self, but we don't want him to have a sense of self. That's really what it's all about oftentimes. And we feel we're being controlled whenever we don't get what I want. So, you know, so I say to him, on Saturday, can you fix the plumbing, you know, the tap? And he, no, he's going fishing. And I go, yeah, he's just controlling. He's making me do that. He's making me fix the tap now. I could say that, couldn't I? He's not making me fix the tap. He might have said, go and ring somebody up and they can do it or something like that. Or I'll ring somebody up Monday and they can do it. But often we'll feel like what we've asked them to do, they are now forcing us into doing by refusing to do what we've asked them. And we need to be very careful with these feelings. Whenever you feel controlled, it is usually because of deep emotional issues in your childhood or multi-generational things, and they've got nothing to do in many cases with the relationship. The key to look at in the relationship is, all right, what happens when I stop an action? So that, for example, I'm cooking meals most nights. So one night I stop cooking a meal. Does he get angry with me? Now, if he does, that is controlling, and he is being controlling. My first step, if I was on the divine love path, would be to do what? I would be truthful with him. You're angry with me only because I didn't cook dinner tonight. I have cooked dinner 6 nights in a row this week. This is telling me that you're not thankful for me cooking meals for you, because I can cook for you 6 times in a row. And the 7th time, when you don't get what you want, you're angry. I feel this is not fair. I feel, you know, and say the truth, say what you're feeling. Now, why do many women avoid that confrontation? Because the man might get even more angry. Right? So what are we really avoiding? The man's rage. We're scared of a man's rage by avoiding this issue. So what do we tell ourselves? Oh, he doesn't love me, he doesn't care for me, I'm just going to leave him. We never tell him why. And, you know, he might be able to deal with just one emotion and that entire situation change. But I'm unwilling to confront the man's rage, and so what I do is I never tell him what the problem really is. So the man's walking around in this la-la land where he doesn't know what he's doing wrong, because I'm unwilling to tell him, because I want him to guess and I want him to not have any anger about before he gets it. But how many times have I had anger when he's told me something? How many times have I, you know, not been able to guess when he's sad or upset or depressed or down or all these things? You see, oftentimes we're not looking at the relationship in a really fair manner. So what we need to do instead is go, all right, this issue of getting what you want is a huge thing about control. And you will often feel controlled when you don't get what you want. And that doesn't mean you're being controlled. It just means you didn't get what you wanted. Right? And like many times we even feel controlled with God. Like, I've asked for God's love, I don't get it. What's God doing? Well, it's not what God's doing. It's what you're doing that stops you from receiving divine love. Not what God's doing. And we also need to look at that many times in our relationship. What are we doing that's causing it? Now, if I had a different focus and instead I said, all right, I am going to learn how to love unconditionally. Myself. And what I'm going to do is I am also going to learn how to be truthful unconditionally. In other words, I'm going to be truthful no matter what the results are. Whether he's angry, sad, depressed, down, suicidal, threatening, makes me feel guilty, whatever the reason, I'm still going to be truthful. And I'm still going to learn to love unconditionally. Now let's see what happens in this relationship. And if in this relationship you're still being controlled, in other words, he gets angry with you whenever he doesn't get what he wants, right? Then relook at the situation and have a look at it. You know, does he want to be in a loving relationship with you? And again, you can't control him being in a loving relationship with you. All you can decide is whether you want to leave the unloving relationship or stay in it. To project at him that he should deal with his problems is actually an unloving projection, right? It's an unloving expectation. If I stay in this place and just tell him the truth, I feel you do not want to deal with your emotions. I feel actually that you do not love me. When I have to cook 6 days in a week and on the seventh day you get angry with me because I didn't cook for you, that's telling me that you don't appreciate me and I feel unappreciated. And go off and I feel my unappreciated emotion. I feel that emotion. Whether I'm with him or not, that emotion's in me and I need to feel it, right? And once I get to that stage, I will actually get to the stage where I cook one day and then I decide, oh, well, I'm not going to cook for him anymore. And he comes home and he says, oh, you know, why is there no meal? Like, and I go, because I've decided that I'm not going to cook for you anymore. Right? Because I feel it's being unloving to myself. And I'll start cooking for you, I feel, when I feel there's more of a loving relationship here with regard to the meal issue. Because just because he's doing it with a meal doesn't mean he's going to do it in every other place of your life. He might, you know, just be totally clueless how to operate a kitchen, you know, like, and never have been taught. And let's face it, most mothers never teach any of their sons how to cook a meal, do they? They expect their daughters to, but they don't teach their sons. And so a lot of guys grow up with totally clueless about, you know, how to butter bread even sometimes. So you know, they've had it done for them most of their life and so they expect it to continue being done. And they might just need to break that one habit and all of a sudden your whole relationship changes because you're now feeling like, wow, this I can feel the love coming from this man. He's now learnt something. He's enjoyed it. Do you know what I mean? And you may feel totally different. The relationship will grow. So just watch these feelings here. If you had said to me, he's abusive, angry, with me all the time, he's always projecting at me that I'm no good, and all of these other things, then of course the answer would be very, very different. You know, of course, though, if I loved unconditionally, I would also love myself unconditionally. And if I'm truthful and I can't speak the truth with my partner because he's in a rage all the time, then I would have to really sincerely look at the relationship and say, well, obviously this isn't working. And even if I love the man, it's still not working and I need to leave it for a while he sorts out his issues. Does that make sense?
Yeah. That's good. It wasn't as confronting as you thought it was going to be. That's the path I've been treading on and getting actually moved along so far that I'm even considering moving in with him. So that was good. I just wondered if sometimes I avoid issues with myself around choosing what I want by going, okay, I'll just keep processing and change myself to fit a situation. I guess that's the question.
Yeah, I don't feel you are changing yourself to suit the situation. I feel what you're trying to do instead is change him. That'd be more honest.
Yeah.
If you were changing yourself to situation, you would bend your own feelings and your own rules all the time, and you know, you'd be changing what you do all the time. And sometimes you'll do that and feel controlled, and he might not even notice. Right? There's been many times where that happens, where you change to suit what you believe his emotions to be, and he doesn't even have those emotions. Mary, you're dying to say something about all this, so say.
Just about losing your sense of self, that's been a huge one for me. And it sort of is, it's like an empty fear, like, oh, I'm going to lose myself. And it's a fear that there's a feeling of like, I'm going to defend that fear, like it could really happen. And really the only way it can ever happen is if I have that injury that love is a bartering system and I am willing to modify myself. Just like AJ was relating, I think, oh, he's sad, so I'm going to do all these things to cheer him up. I'll deny how I feel, and then that'll make the relationship harmonious. That's what I feel. And that's my addiction to making the relationship harmonious and not wanting to live in truth unconditionally. So for me, that losing my sense of self, that I've done that in every relationship in my life, but it hasn't been really about the other person. It's been about my addiction to everyone loving me, everything feeling good. And so it was really a space that I had to get to in myself. And of course it doesn't work with AJ because he's like, what are you doing? and he doesn't want me to make him feel better.
And I don't want Mary to lose her sense of self. Yeah. So whenever I notice her doing something for me that I feel that she doesn't actually want to do, even if I want it, I stop her from doing it. I say, no, Mary, actually, like, while it's lovely you want to do this thing, and it'd be lovely from my perspective that you do it, you don't want to do it. And so under those circumstances, I can't accept you doing it, like because you don't want to. And I can't engage in that if you don't want to.
Yeah, but the truth was, the fear came from the fact that I feel like love equals losing your sense of self. Like, if I'm going to love someone, I'm going to barter with them, I'm going to give away myself to them, when really that's not love. But that was huge for me to confront. Mm. Yeah.
So the truth is, with controlled, you can only ever be controlled when you allow it. Yeah. The truth is, with losing sense of self, you can only ever lose your sense of self if you decide to stay away from yourself. Yeah. That's the only time you can ever lose your sense of self. Somebody else can't take it away from you. No. You have to give it away. Now, I'm not saying as a child here, because obviously as a child, people can control you and take your sense of self away from you. I'm saying as an adult, the only way for you to lose your sense of self is for you to give your sense of self away. And the only way for you to be controlled is by you allowing yourself to be controlled. So the fear of being controlled and the fear of losing your sense of self are two very unfounded fears that really are based around, and if you look at your actions, you'll find that you are actually more controlling because of the fear and more about him losing his sense of self because of that fear. You see, every time we have a fear, like of being controlled, we actually become more controlling to the other person. Whenever we have a fear of losing our sense of self, we actually want the other person to tell us our sense of self. Do you see what I'm saying? We're actually controlling, we're doing what we're afraid of to the other person, to prevent the other person from doing it to us. Right? And it's very powerful once you see, every time you feel that, you see, this is about myself. This is what's going on inside of me. Yeah.
Yeah. One of the reasons why I've valued this relationship is that I feel that I can actually work with this stuff with him.
Yeah.
And he has projected anger at me a fair bit, but then he's been open to conversation.
Yeah. And how has he apologized for his anger with you after he's felt it? See, that would be my question. My question is, if a person has been angry with you and then they realise that, not that what they were saying was wrong, but that their anger was wrong, right, then you've got something to work with here. Does that make sense? Like, you've got something to actually work with. This person desires growth. And so the key question becomes, does the person desire growth as much as I do? Do they desire to actually grow in the relationship as much as I am? Are they passionate about the relationship between you and them? Does he have a strong desire for you? Right? And yeah. And a lot of times many women will feel a desire from a man and actually think it's control. Right? But we were just having this conversation yesterday, myself and Mary in the car, where every time I have a longing for Mary, Mary feels that I wish to control her. And I'm saying, no, hang on a sec. Let's turn it around to be God relationship for a moment. God says to us that the only way we receive divine love is by having a longing for that love. Now, why is a longing for love necessary to receiving love? Well, what a longing for love does is it opens your heart. Right? And because your heart is now open, any love that the person gives you can be received. But if you don't have a longing for it, it's just like, I can take it or leave it. That kind of feeling, how does that feel on the opposite end when you're in a relationship? If somebody can say to you, I can take it or leave it with your love, you know, what are they basically telling you? I can take you or leave you, doesn't really matter, you're not that important to me. You see, God, the reason why God's love flows into the person who desires it is because the process of desiring it opens your soul to the person you're desiring it from, right? And most people are unwilling to do that until the other person loves them, you know what I mean? It's like we're so worried about being vulnerable and open and so worried about whether we're going to handle the fact that they're not going to love us that we don't open our heart by having a longing for that love. But if you imagine for a moment a relationship now where both people are longing for the love to enter their soul from the other person, that means that both people are emotionally open and vulnerable to the love that's coming to them from the other person. So now any love that I feel for Mary, for example, any love I feel for her will automatically enter her because she has a longing for it to enter her. Does that make sense? She won't be blocking my love. And any love Mary has for me will automatically enter me because I'm open, because I have a longing for that love to enter me. And I won't be pushing it away. I won't be blocking it. I won't be trying to shut down the relationship. I'll actually be open to receiving it. And part of the problem with love relationships on the earth is that most of us are so afraid of getting hurt that we're unwilling to open our hearts to have a longing for the love to enter us. And we're so afraid of getting hurt, and we're so afraid that we're not going to cope with the emotion of it, of being hurt, by them not loving us. And this all relates to us really not being loved as a child. Got nothing to do with the person most of the time. And that we actually close down ourselves towards a potentially fantastic relationship just by actually saying, no, no, I'm not going to open my heart to them until they prove to me that they're going to open their heart to me. And lo and behold, the other fella's got the same, or the other person has got the same emotional injury. I'm not going to open my heart to them until they, you know. And so what happens is the relationship never really develops. And we can have like 10 years with a person but never really feel loved because we're both blocking it. So it would be far better to focus. Look at these issues as just issues that you can just put aside for a moment and look at the issue of opening your heart to have a longing for his love and loving him unconditionally and telling him the truth unconditionally and see what happens. And if what happens is a rejection of your love, then allow yourself to feel the grief of that because it's related to your childhood in some way. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank
Does that
you.
Make sense? Okay.
My question goes back to you asked or you put a scenario about a three-year-old, an incident happening to a three-year-old towards a mother.
Mm-hmm.
Can that not happen, like being a male, can that happen to the same gender like you?
Of course, yeah. Any incident can happen to any adult person.
If it's to do with the right side or
yeah.
back or front or...
Yep, and also, like if I'm a male and I have right side body issues, it might relate to my father or it might relate to how I actually view myself, in most cases both. Does that make sense?
Yep.
If I am a woman and I have left side body issues, then it might relate to how I'm viewing my mother, but highly likely also it's going to relate to how I view myself as a woman.
So does that mean you sort of, not prolong your pain, but you put your hand in your pain, so to speak? Is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah, what I said was basically you can use your body, if you stay in your body, you can use your body pain to access your emotion. Yep. If you get out of your body, you're not going to be able to use your body's pain to access your emotion because you're already out of your body and you don't want to feel your body's pain. Most of the time what we're trying to do is we're trying to avoid our body's pain. And that's why there's all this market for painkillers and, you know, that they're all about avoiding the underlying causal emotion. When we actually allow ourselves to get into the pain of our body, we very rapidly get to causal emotion generally. So the key is to let yourself do that.
Just let it overwhelm me.
Let the pain overwhelm you emotionally. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a bit like, how many of you have clobbered yourself in the head with the kitchen, like, you know, you've come up, you know, with all of the effort of your head and bang right into the corner of a kitchen cupboard or something. And there's this instant, like, feeling of, like, just shock, but also the intense pain of your head being hit like that, and it might even start bleeding, whatever. But the majority of us avoid in that moment just crying in pain. Do you notice that? Like, we'll either get angry or we'll get frustrated or we'll slam the thing or everything else but actually cry that about the pain. My suggestion is if you cry about the pain, you'll actually even find out what actually emotion that caused that accident in the first place. And the same applies to every pain in your body. If you let yourself just tune into the pain and cry about the pain, what will happen quite frequently is you'll access the emotion. We were talking last night, I think it was, about how there's many forms of crying. And a lot of, oftentimes when you talk to people about that, they go, no, there's not, it's just crying, you know, like, but no, there actually is many forms of crying. There's angry crying. You've done that, some of you, like, you know, you cry in frustration and rage, you know. There's fear crying. Have you ever done that? Like, where you've just been so afraid, you can't stop yourself from crying. Or you're terrified and you just can't stop yourself from crying. There's shame-based crying, where you're so ashamed of yourself and feel so disgusting, you just can't help but cry. Does that make sense? So there's all these different forms of crying. And a lot of them are connected with your body in some way.
Thank you very much, Anya.
Yep. So let yourself connect with your body. Yep.
What about appendicitis?
Sorry.
What What about appendicitis with the right side of the body?
Appendicitis with the right side of the body.
Yeah, well, the appendix is on the right side, of course. So does that mean you've got a lot of people who have appendicitis or appendix taken out? They have father issues.
Certainly. Yeah.
Good. I'm glad the fathers are blamed for something. Well, it seems to be stemming towards the
having
the
a father issue doesn't mean the father is to blame. Just like having a mother issue doesn't mean the mother is to blame. You see what happens as a as
well. My mother's not totally to blame because I had my appendix out.
But your emotions towards the male might be to blame.
Yes, definitely.
Okay. Let's have a look at it from a here's our dad. Here's our mum. If you think about it, there's actually four groups of emotions that will enter us as a child, no matter what gender, right? So let's say I'm a female child. There's four groups of emotions that are going to enter me. There's the one group, first group is what dad feels about himself. Does that make sense? All the feelings that dad has about himself will have an entry point in me at some point. And if I identify with my father, they'll even enter me even more than they would if I identified with my mother or none of my parents. What's the second group of emotions? Is what mum feels about herself. And this here we're talking about just the emotions about genders, about the intergender issues. So there's two groups of emotions that can enter me. Then there's what dad feels about women. Right? And let's put in brackets. Mum. His mum. Where it all came from is often the case. And it's also going to be what he felt about my mum in this case. And then there's what mum feels about men. Right? And her dad. Right? Now, in this relationship, this man might be a loving, caring man. But mum feels men are bastards. Right? The emotion, if I identify with my mum, is going to be that men are bastards. I am going to feel men are bastards, and dad hasn't done anything about it under those circumstances. Does that make sense? If dad has an emotion about mum, that women are bitches. Right? But mum is just this nice, caring, easygoing person who has just a lot of love in her. But he just feels that about women. That's what he feels about women. What am I going to take on? If I'm a girl child, I'm going to feel I'm a bitch. Or at least that all other women are. Does that make sense? And so what happens a lot is that it doesn't necessarily mean if you've got a man issue that it came from your dad, because it can actually come from your mum. And it doesn't mean that if you've got a woman issue that it came from your mum. It might actually have come from your dad. Does that make sense? So a lot of times when we look at the issues of intergender, and this is why blame is a very, not a very positive emotion, because in the end we often have a woman, we might have a woman issue as a child, we might have a woman issue, but actually it'd be dad's fault that woman issue entered me through the projection of emotions that dad was giving me all the way through my life and giving my mum all the way through my life. And what happened between dad and mum often defines my viewpoint of love. Right? So if dad was like a big, burly man who protected mum securely, and mum loved the security she got from it, let's say I'm a woman, I grow up to be an adult woman, and I'm looking for the big, burly man who can protect me. That's love. Right? And a shorter man, bit slimmer, comes along, and he's just a lovely person. I connect with him on this level, on that level, on this level, on that level, but I'm not attracted to him because he's not Dad. He's not a big, burly man. Because what I learned, love, was that Dad was a big, burly man, and he was, you know, had issues where he could protect Mum, and I felt that protection is love. Is protection love? No. No. Protection is not love, right? So I am actually out of harmony in my belief system because of what happened between Dad and Mum. So you can actually grow up believing that you're not attracted to some type of people, and your soulmate be the exactly person that you're not attracted to because of you're hooked into still what your beliefs of love are based on what Dad was like and what Mum was like. And we need to heal all of those things before we're ever going to attract a real relationship that's going to be loving and sexually compatible and all the other things. Because all we're doing there is we're just hooking into these old belief systems that are often seriously in error. And we're doing that all the time. Now, of course, what Dad feels about God also affects my beliefs about God. And what Mum feels about God affects my beliefs about God. So can you see, also, as a child, I'm looking up at these people, and what I see them doing, I'll believe God does. So can you see how there's a whole series of injuries that can happen through this interaction with our parents that we come away from, and we're often thinking one thing about it, but in reality it was caused by something totally left field that we don't even realise. And that's why the intellect is not a very powerful tool to actually dealing with these emotions. That's why we need to actually feel the emotion, because when you feel the emotion, the cause and where it came from is all exposed in the process of feeling it. If you don't let yourself feel it, and instead you intellectually try to guess it, what often happens is we're way, way off beam, right, as a result. So allow yourself... One very powerful way to deal with a lot of causal emotion is to look at how Dad feels about himself and look at how he feels about women and how he's treated women all of his life, and to look at how Mum feels about herself and look at how Mum feels about men and how she's treated men all of her life, and add all that together, because that's my set of emotional injuries, intergender emotional injuries right there.
Yeah, thank you, AJ, for explaining that, because yep. I was beginning to think it was one-sided.
So, no.
Because I've had problems with controlling issues in my mother's side of the family.
Yep.
But I really, it's more prominent there, but I would think it's in my father's side as well.
Yep.
And so therefore I've taken that on.
Yep.
And I'm pretty good at controlling as well.
Yep.
Although I have been making every effort Well, I've been recognising it anyway. And
so you're at least recognising when you're controlling. Yeah, so that's good.
That's a step.
That's a step in the right direction.
And I'm letting go and backing off. And
the next step is to actually feel the emotion you feel when you wanted to control. Like what was the emotion you were avoiding by controlling? If you can allow yourself to feel about that, that's a very powerful place, because you get to what's going on inside of yourself.
Okay, and thank you. I'll do that. Yeah. And we only have one child, and his big issue is control as well, because he sees me as the big controlling person in the family.
Yep.
And the mother has been getting a bit of a flack tonight, and so because I'm sensitive towards that, because I'm getting whatever I say often.
And in fact, your entire question was about feeling like mothers are being attacked and men are not.
And I'm constantly being attacked at the moment. Philip, the father can do no wrong.
And all I've been doing tonight is stating the truth about situations rather than attacking any gender. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yes, but the mother has been sort of mentioned a lot more than.
Because of many of the questions that are being asked are related to this.
Well, so therefore. What I've been thinking lately is the mother, is it a normal process for all sons to automatically feel the mother is to blame through lack of love that they have received or lack of nurturing?
No, it's not automatic.
But
if your son feels that way, my suggestion is really go into that emotionally and look very carefully at yourself with more scrutiny.
Hmm.
Because often our children are right. Not in the way that we think. Because, often what happens is that we have had a projection coming out of us without saying words and without even acting upon the projection, but that is the thing the child feels the most, right? It's the feeling coming from us that the child feels the most. And when we are controlling, the feeling that our child is feeling the most from us is actually fear. The only time we desire to control other people is because we are afraid of something. You follow that?
Yeah.
Now, often we say, oh, controlling women, you know, that's a terrible thing, as if it's a terrible thing. We judge that. But actually, in judging that, we're not looking at its source. And its source is actually how afraid the woman is. That's the source of the control. So if your son felt right from a young age that a lot of fear in the feminine side of the family, and then he felt that he had to actually do something about that fear to alleviate that fear in the women, in particular with mum, then he is going to grow up feeling like he's being controlled the entire time when you might not have actually said a word. Does that make sense? And this is why it's so important to look at all these interactions, because there is truth in these interactions, but it's not always the truth the child is speaking of. It can often be a totally different emotion that they've been feeling from you that they can't identify. Also, what happens when the child doesn't do what you want? Look really closely at that. Because I've heard so many parents say, oh, I've been a great parent. And then as soon as their child doesn't do what they want, bang, bang, bang. You know, there's all this projection. You shouldn't be doing that. I'm really worried about you. I'm really in a panic about you. There's all this fear coming at them. You know, if you do that, you may lose your house. You may lose your job. You may lose your marriage. What about your children? You know what I mean? And there's the control. There's all of that fear coming up, which converts into trying to control a person. And so if you can allow yourself to feel about all of these things as a parent, the majority of things that have to be dealt with in the spirit world relate to when we've been damaging to our children as parents. The majority of people on the planet don't damage many other people very severely except for their own children, right? And as a result of that, many times we think we've been loving as parents and we want to believe we've been loving as parents, and from God's perspective, we have not been loving. And remember what I spoke with when I spoke with John Lennon earlier. I said it doesn't matter what you think is loving. What matters is what God knows is loving, and me coming to see what God knows is loving. And obviously fear and the projection of fear on our children is never a loving act, ever. And it creates all sorts of damage to our children. And we might feel justified in having the fear, but there is no justification from God's perspective in having fear. God created a perfect universe, perfect laws. There's no need for any fear. It's only because we've walked away from God that we have fear in the end. And the fear is what damages. The fear is the opposite to truth. And it's the fear that finishes up causing us to even control, to even want to control someone else, and why they feel the feelings of control.
Well, I've certainly felt that recently, but it's been for the reverse, because we're very close in certain ways that we're very similar as well, makeup mentally and emotionally, and I don't know, there's a mirror image thing that we press each other's buttons pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
And so
can I point out to you though that your child is actually going to expose your emotional injuries more rapidly than any other person on the planet?
Yes, he does it regularly. Yeah. Apart from my mother.
But there is a feeling coming from you that it's something to do with him.
Well, that's what I was trying to get to. This recently, we do have our explosive moments, mm-hmm. but fortunately they're not that frequent.
It would be better to say for you to say, you know how you said we have
yes.
explosive moments?
Mm-hmm.
In that, there's quite a lot of, like, sharing of the responsibility of the explosive moment. Yes. By saying, we had an explosive moment, you're actually saying that I'm just as explosive as you are in that moment. Does that make sense? That's what you're really saying, by we have explosive moment. The reality actually is that everything your son feels came from you or his father. Everything. So actually, it's not we having an explosive moment. You are actually having an explosive moment with yourself, your own creation.
Well, that's what I was been thinking about tonight, and that's what I wanted to actually mention an hour ago, or when you mentioned anger, was this explosive moment that well, he had, because he was the one that exploded with violent anger, really incredible anger towards me over me so-called controlling an issue that really wasn't a control, but to him it was, and he...
No, stop. This is where it's very important as parents. Many parents are still doing this, and you've got to stop doing this if you want to progress towards God. The reality is, every emotion my son, daughter, no matter what age, is reflecting back at me has something to do with me because I created it in them. So you can dismiss it by saying that actually he felt control, but I wasn't controlling. That is not looking at your part. There is something in here that is actually entirely your part that you played in this process. Entirely.
Well, it was to begin with, and then when the anger developed, that is what I'm thinking about tonight, is it is the mirror image. That anger that developed, was that a total mirror image developed from me?
Of course. Any anger...
So I'm fully responsible for it then?
Yes. Yes. You're not fully responsible for his adult reaction in the sense that he, you know, as an adult, he has responsibility for his anger. But you need to look at the underlying cause. The cause must... If he's angry with you as the parent, the cause must have come from you at some point. Who created his anger? Who created his anger was... Like, remember we have anger, and then under the anger is fear, and under the fear generally is sadness, right? So who created his anger? Well, his fear creates his anger. Who created his fear? Well, his sadness created his fear. His desire to get away from his sadness created his fear, right? Who created his sadness? No one else other than both of his parents and the environment he lived in as he was growing up. So... If my son is angry with me, he is angry with me, and I am now coming face to face with my own creation. This is my own creation. Now, he is just responding to my own creation. And when you own it, you will find that you take away, for a start, his rage will just rapidly dissipate when you own it, for a start. And you need to own it. It's not necessarily what he's talking about as to why he's angry, by the way, but you need to own the fact that getting this anger back from him is something in you created this, something in you. And if he's angry with Dad, it's something in Dad that created that. Does that make sense? And you need to own it as a parent. And when you own it as a parent, you don't go, we... referring to your child, had this blow up. You go, I created this feeling in my son where he got angry with me. And I need to identify what it is that I created. And it might not be controlled. It might be another thing that he doesn't identify. But I created something to create this anger that's coming back at me. I created something. And when I own that as a parent, you're starting to take real responsibility and feel repentant for what we've done as parents. And as you own that, you'll find rapidly, very rapidly, your relationship will become smooth with your children. So my relationship with my sons now is really like ultra, ultra smooth. Not because we're untruthful with each other, because we're 100% truthful with each other all the time, as Mary will attest to, right? But it is ultra smooth because I have taken ownership of every single bit of damage that I have perpetrated in my sons. Every single bit. And whenever they've ever been angry with me, I've never gotten angry in return or gotten upset in return or blamed them in return or any of those things, because I see them as my creation. Every single thing that they have had in their life. and the, as far-reaching, wide-ranging things that they've had to deal with in their life, and some of times been quite upset with me and angry with me, not talking to me for months, sometimes a year or two, right, where they haven't spoken to me. And every single time it was something that I created, every single time. Can we have the microphone, sir? What's the time? It's after 10, isn't it? Yeah, we need to finish.
I'm just wondering how that description example you just gave relates to our relationship to our Creator. What's our Creator's responsibility to us in that
relationship? The difference between God and ourselves is that we walked away from God. God never walked away from us. And all of these problems we have with our own children are all the results in the end of our walking away from knowing what love is ourselves. So in the process of our walking away from God, and all of us at some point have done it in our lives, we walk away from God in some way, and in every way is whenever we break one of his laws about love and so forth. Every time we do that, we are basically distancing ourselves from God and therefore distancing ourselves about our concept of love. We don't understand love anymore. Is it mic on? Because I can just. It just says power. Switch it to power. Just wait for a few seconds. Yeah, let's give it on.
I'm trying to understand, because to me I feel like my relationship with my God, as you said, is a parental relationship, and part, you know, like I see God as my father and my mother.
Mm-hmm.
And part of what you described then to me, how I perceived it, was that as a parent to a child, to our creation, we always have a responsibility for how they have taken on our pain or how they've been damaged.
Mm-hmm.
So does God not have that responsibility to us as his creation?
Well, no, I don't have a responsibility to my children for the good things that I've given to them, in terms of that, because good things don't cause damage.
Okay.
And God, as a parent, has only ever given us good things.
Okay,
does that make sense? We only have a responsibility to bear as parents for the negative things that we create in our children. And of course, we created those because of our own lack of understanding of love and our own lack of understanding generally of how the universe and everything else works. God, of course, has an understanding of how everything works and only has ever given us good things. And what we've done with those good things is we've distorted them, changed them, we've decided to walk away, become self-reliant, and in the process of doing that, don't know what love is anymore, and then in the process of doing that, damaged our children's concept.
That makes perfect sense, love. Thank you.
Yeah, so yeah, so you don't need to, one of the things I'll be talking about this coming weekend up at Butterham is faith, and one thing that's so important to have is faith that God is good in this process. If you have faith that God is good, you will never go wrong in your progression to God. It's because of our lack of faith that God is good, because of all the things we see happening around us, that we want to have a tendency to blame on God and all these other things, we don't have a faith that God is good. And then we have mistrust. And then we have, you know what I mean? And we start mistrusting God. We don't think God's doing the right thing. But if you can understand that God created every single law in this universe of ours based around love of you, every single law is actually there to demonstrate God's love of you. And if you can remember that all the way through your progression, you won't go wrong in any of your spiritual progression. It's as soon as you forget that and you start mistrusting God and say, oh, this bloody law of attraction, this is not, you know, this is not a loving thing, and this thing's not good and that thing's not good, and we get really angry and upset about what God's done, and we, you know, we say, oh, what about the millions of people who are starving to death? You know, God's doing that too, and we start blaming God for that. When we go into that place, that's where we're just hooking in to the damage that's already been done and making it even worse. And God is love. God is not just love, right? Because God is an entity who has love, but God is the personification of love, certainly. And if we keep that in mind, that God is good, God is love all the time, any time we hear anything from anybody else in the universe about something about criticism of God not being loving, we know immediately that is an untruth. And if we trust that, you will never go wrong in your progression towards God. Yeah. But we must end up. It must be past 10 now. And I said I was... Yeah. Thanks. And thanks to Monica as well for doing that channeling for us. And thank you too for your donations. And I know some of you got a long trip home tonight, so safe journeys home. And the reason why Monica did some of this channeling in the group was that my suggestion, because we're trying to help Monica work through some emotions about, you know, being exposed to other people's criticism, if you like. And so that's why we did that tonight. But I hope you enjoyed that. Thanks for your time, though, guys. So, yeah.